The last time I interviewed you, you said you always have hope for America, and you still seem to be hopeful. But a lot has happened since then. The big lie, the insurrection, the worst days of pandemic. There are a lot of people out there for whom it probably seems very dark out there at times. A lot of people out there might feel despair, not hope for the future because of the pandemic, because of the state of American democracy, because of the threats to American democracy. Where does your hope come from?
Perspective, context. From realizing that it's not supposed to be a straight line to progress. It never has been, and that there's ebb and flow, and you take steps back. But we've come through, you know, I was of age in the 60s. You know, my first memories are of Martin Luther King Jr. and Robert Kennedy being killed. And so we are a complicated people, and it's a complicated story in America. And we like to mythologize it because it makes us a little bit more comfortable. But to be able to see things clearly is not to be despairing, but to be optimistic that fair-minded people, you know, working together can make incremental progress over time. And that ain't nothing. And that real people making real decisions can change things. And overwhelmingly, I still believe that this is an experiment worth having. You know, admittedly, the country feels right now like it's in kind of a joint custody arrangement. Like sometimes you stay with dad, sometimes you stay with mom, and we go through it. But why wouldn't you be optimistic? What, name another time you'd rather be alive? Just, I can't think of one. And yeah, is social media annoying? Yes. Would I rather be alive in the 40s? No. Like, this is, think of the opportunities. Have you met younger people? There's some of them are brilliant.
Yeah, they're great.
Coming up with all kinds of great stuff.
They're pretty great.
And I'm sure there's a couple of evil geniuses out there too, and we're gonna have to deal with their nonsense. But for the most part, everybody's doing the best they can. And there's a lot of really powerful energy and vitality being put towards trying to make stuff better. So I prefer to think that they will be triumphant, but that it's not a fait accompli, that we are not guaranteed anything. And if you look at it like you're not guaranteed anything, there is no entitlement in a society to progress or making things better.
It's been 9 months since Joe Biden took office. Do you think he's leading the nation with the urgency you're calling for?
I don't think anybody is. I think most of the urgency that the nation is calling for comes from the outside of Washington. First of all, it's an overwhelming gig, clearly. We've gotten to a point with the stasis in the government that tons of the positions that you would normally need to function aren't even filled anymore. Like at a certain point, it feels like, you know, this country is that, you ever go into a deli at like 9:30 and you want a sandwich and you walk in and like they're saran wrapping all the stuff and you're like, hey man, can I get a sandwich? You're like, yeah, no sandwich. You're like, but you're open till 11. You're like, yeah, but no sandwiches. But you have a sandwich shop. You go like, hey, we're done making sandwiches. Like in some respects, that's what it feels like. And they've come up with an awful lot of good ideas, I think. And
yeah.
I'm hoping that some of them get implemented, but it's hard to believe in the process of them getting implemented, especially when you've got one group who basically their entire governing ethos is government is the enemy unless we control it. So if you control the government, we will do everything we can to make sure that it doesn't work, so that we can run advertisements saying government doesn't work until we take control of it, and then we get to do whatever we want. So it's, you know, it's pretty cynical strategy.
There's a big debate going on right now in the Democratic Party about how to appeal to voters in 2022. There are a lot of social issues getting a lot of attention. Governor Gavin Newsom in California just signed a law requiring gender-neutral toy sections in stores. There's obviously a lot of debate across the country, not all of it well-informed, about critical race theory and how race is taught in schools. Do you have concerns about how these debates are taking place? Obviously, I'm not talking about how they're depicted in right-wing media, because it doesn't matter what the Democrats do or liberals do for right-wing media to lie about it. But there are a number of independent voters who might not understand what's going on.
Yeah. I mean, there are a lot of things a lot of people don't understand, and it's something's either right and common sense. I mean, I do think there are ways to accomplish some of these goals in ways that, but you can't govern to the lowest common denominator. You can't. I think one of the difficulties, and again, it's with the way that the lens through which we view everything is based on, and what will that mean for the midterms? Or what? I saw a great headline in Politico as Afghanistan was descending into chaos in that final week. And the headline in Politico, this is the top line headline, the one with the 40, you know, point font, whatever it was. It said, "Why Afghanistan may not matter in the midterms." And then the subhead was, "And why it might."
They have a point.
But that's our journalism, right, man? Isn't that, like, how many times have you seen stories about the battle over masks? That's the Karen yelling in the store and the people throwing them out and all that. And how many stories have we seen about the efficacy of masks or the why? Or the actual, like, there are some, but the overwhelming majority of stories seek to expose the conflict lines.
But do you think it's all about the media? There isn't anything to the degree of that sometimes activists on the left risk alienating a culture instead of educating and then bringing people in? That's one of the criticisms.
Their job isn't to educate necessarily. I mean, I agree with you. I'm uncomfortable with certain, like, activism that feels performative. I think a lot of times it's not particularly helpful. And if your goal is to create a change there, sometimes that performative activism isn't particularly helpful. But in the scheme of things, performative activism gets people's attention. And if the follow-up to that conversation is fruitful, it can be really effective. But I don't generally think that the problem in democratic politics lies with activists. I just don't think that that's a fair assessment of what's wrong with, democratic politics.
You think that it's that democratic politicians don't deliver enough to the people that they were elected to represent? Is that more accurate?
I think that their ability sometimes to respond in kind with smart and competent programs is probably a bigger problem. And so everybody wants to talk about, like, that question you said about gender neutral. I can't remember what you said. Gender neutral
sections and toy stores. It's a law that the governor just passed and signed into law.
But honestly, like, that law, like, who gives a shit? Do you know what I mean? Like, in terms of the importance of the running of California, yeah, it's a law. Who's it really going to impact? It reminds me of, you know, somebody said to me that they were upset the other day that things had gotten so out of hand. Oh, Demi Lovato wanted to be referred to as they. That was the pronoun that Demi Lovato wanted to use. And this person went, this is just, it's out of hand. And I said, well, I've got really good news for you then. You don't know Demi Lovato. So you're never going to have to really be in this situation. And whatever pronoun you use in conversation, she will be fine, because you don't know Demi Lovato. And if you ever did meet Demi Lovato and you used the wrong pronoun, I'm sure Demi Lovato would be like, oh, I'm sorry, I prefer this one. And then it would be good done. But in the media, that story is ubiquitous. And it's, I think the media does a terrible job at de-escalation.
Yeah.
And de-escalation is the antidote to all this nonsense. And I don't mean civility, and I don't mean nonpartisanship. I mean focusing on things that are more urgent and elemental in people's lives and really hammering away at those things.
Yeah.
Rather than purely the emotional fault lines that occur in societies.